Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Good evening, everyone. My name is Sam Raskoff, and I'm a law professor here. I've had the privilege of teaching some of you in my specialty classes in national security law or in my first year class, administrative and regulatory state. But I'm with you this evening not in my capacity as teacher so much as my capacity as the faculty advisor of the Frank Guarini Institute for Government Leadership, a position that I assumed last year, which was the very first year of our experiment, which was spearheaded and generously funded by Congressman Guarini, who's with us this evening and is also endowed this evening's lecture. And the purpose of the Guarini Institute is really to harness energy that is very, very present here at NYU Law School, and that is the energy of the students, of faculty, and of other members of our extended community in the pursuit of public service and, frankly, in the pursuit of traditional government service jobs in the executive branch, in the courts, and especially also in the legislature, where Congressman Guarini obviously served himself. I'll tell you a little bit more about him in a moment. But suffice it to say that Congressman Guarini's generosity to the law school in founding the Government Leadership Institute, but also in making this evening possible, I think taps into something very deep and very alive in the student body here, something that I've come into contact with a lot with students, and that is a real passion for public service, a real commitment to the enterprise of government, and a desire in the most practical level to become involved. There's no better person, I think, to embody that kind of energy and to tap into it and to, frankly, supply some more energy into this room this evening than our distinguished lecturer this evening. Let me tell you a little bit more about the two gentlemen, frankly, who made this evening possible. And I'd like to do so by describing, very briefly, a species of human being in our American society that I regard as a species that's on the verge of extinction. And that is the species Politiconus seriosus. What makes a serious politician? What makes a member of this increasingly rare and tragically, it would seem, all but extinct species? Well, in Congressman Guarini, our patron for this evening, it entails membership in the greatest generation, service in the United States Navy during World War II, two terms in the legislature in New Jersey, seven terms in the House of Representatives, service as a delegate to the NATO Convention in London, and also a Senate-confirmed appointment to be the United States representative to the General Assembly of the United Nations. But candidly, it's a lot more than just a litany of enormously impressive accomplishments. It's also a sensibility that Congressman Guarini embodies and has embodied throughout his career, both in government and subsequent to his traditional public service in the role of entrepreneur and businessman and benefactor and in ongoing public service that he does, not while wearing an official cloak. And that is the sensibility of someone who cares deeply about the issues, is committed to working to find practical solutions to seemingly intractable problems, and does so in a way that honors and respects the fact that he serves as a representative of the people, never losing the touch of someone who understands that the source of his authority in our society and the source of his power comes from the people themselves. So Congressman Guarini certainly embodies Politiconus seriosus. So too does our distinguished speaker this evening, Hakeem Jeffries. Assemblyman Jeffries? Hakeem is now serving in his second term in the New York State Legislature, and he's been an enormously influential lawmaker across a wide range of very difficult policy issues. Let me give you a sense of some of the legislation that he has essentially spearheaded. First, there's Project Reclaim, which is legislation that transforms vacant luxury housing that essentially was terminated because of the economic conditions that prevail, and to turn those homes into affordable homes for middle class and lower middle class people. He successfully advocated for new legislation that limits the ability of the police department not just to gather information, but to repose certain information that was derived from so-called stop and frisk stops, and to use that information for ongoing data mining purposes. This is an enormously difficult thing to do. I know, having worked in the police department, how much political clout the police department enjoys and how difficult it is to do anything, to accomplish anything in Albany or anywhere, to actually push back against some of the initiatives from the NYPD. And Hakeem Jeffries accomplished that with enormous success. He's also been very involved in a sort of quirky issue, or at least to my mind it's quirky, but I find it fascinating, namely an issue regarding prison gerrymandering. Who knew that New York State, thanks to Assemblyman Jeffries, is now the second state in the union where incarcerated individuals are regarded as part of their home communities for purposes of the apportionment of congressional seats? A fascinating and important issue, and one, you know, use a little bit of imagination, one that has obvious kind of bottom line political implications. Hakeem is now running for the United States Congress and for the 10th Congressional District. He announced as much last week. And so he may well be soon following in the distinguished footsteps of Congressman Guarini, migrating from state legislative activities to the federal legislature. Now, some have called him the Barack of Brooklyn. But I suspect that over time, they may start referring to the current occupant of 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue as the Hakeem of Washington. So, in short, in order to become a member of this increasingly extinct breed of serious politicians, you have to honor your commitment to the people who put you in office. You have to be true to your core convictions while remaining flexible and building larger coalitions. And you have to do one more exceedingly important thing that I haven't mentioned thus far. You have to get a law degree from NYU. Congressman Guarini was wise to have done so in 1950 and then again in 1955 for his LLM. Assemblyman Jeffries was wise to have done so in 1997 when he earned his JD here with high honors, served as a federal law clerk afterwards, was a member of the Law Review, and was an otherwise an enormously distinguished citizen of NYU. So that's how you become a member of Politiconus Seriosus. Without further ado, please join me in welcoming Hakeem Jeffries.
Well, good evening, everyone, and thank you very much for those very generous words of introduction, for your leadership of this very important program, and for adding that new designation to myself and the congressperson. I'm going to make sure I add that to my Wikipedia page. We're real thankful for the leadership of this very important endeavor. And of course, the Congressman Guarini, who's had a magnificent career in many ways, has been such a tremendous and a distinguished public servant, fought for freedom abroad during World War II, and then came back home and fought for freedom and political liberty and change in New Jersey, and then subsequently as United States Congressperson, is someone for me and many others in my generation to look to as it relates to his leadership in Congress, as well as his effort to help usher in an entire new generation into the body politic and government as we move forward. And so I'm thankful for the Congressman, his efforts, and his presence. You know, as was mentioned, I'm a graduate of NYU Law School, proud to have gone to this wonderful institution. Upon graduating, had the opportunity to clerk for a year over at the United States District Court for the Southern District of New York. And then went on to practice law for a few years, litigation department at Paul Weiss, where I received what I believe was tremendous training in the art and science of the law and litigation, building upon those previous experiences that I had. And then I made a decision. You know, I'm a kid who grew up in Brooklyn, Crown Heights, returned home once I came back to New York for law school, and planted myself back in the community. And made the decision after a few years of practicing law that I wanted to use the advocacy skills and the training that I had acquired as a law student and as a lawyer on behalf of the communities that I hope to represent in Central Brooklyn in the legislature. And so I make this decision that I'm going to run for a seat in the New York State Assembly, the People's House, and challenge a 20-year incumbent. Who was at the time backed by the Brooklyn Democratic machine, the Albany political establishment. I'm just a young lawyer. I have no name recognition, no money in the bank, no prior political involvement. And so I had a conversation with a local community activist, and I said to him that I was planning on running and laid out the reasons why. And in response, he asked a very pertinent question. He said, well, Hakeem, how many people can you actually count on to vote for you on election day? I paused for the moment, thought about it, and then with all the confidence that I could muster, I said, I can count on two people, myself and my wife. And then I thought about that answer for a moment. Some of y'all may be married. And Congressman, I realize that even that calculation could be a little bit shaky. Because on any given night, if a brother wasn't doing the right thing at home, I could suffer a 50% erosion of my electoral base. But somehow we managed to hold a coalition together. I didn't win, but I got more than 40% of the vote and laid the foundation, shocked the establishment for me to ultimately be successful just a few years later and get elected to the New York State Assembly. And so I arrive in Albany ready to tackle the big issues, whether that's housing or education, unemployment, and certainly the criminal justice system, which I believed was in desperate need of reform. And I was dedicating to fighting as hard as I can on this issue. And I reflected upon the fact 150 years ago, President Lincoln once asked the question, publicly pondered the question, how do you create a more perfect union? And he asked the question, of course, in the context of the Civil War that was raging at the time that threatened to tear this country apart. And since that moment in this country, year after year, decade after decade, century after century, certainly, we've made tremendous progress. But it's still a relevant question for all of us to ask. How do we create a more perfect union? And it was clear to me that in the context of the criminal justice system, that there was a lot of work that needed to be done to create a system that was fairer and more equitable, that had one set of laws applied evenly to everyone, regardless of race or gender or religion or sexual orientation. And that would be a worthy endeavor for me to tackle. Now, at times, it can be a tough issue because it's one that's easily demonized by your opponents, who like to cast you as either anti-police, anti-public safety, even pro-criminal, or the type of things that could be hurled out at you. But it was clear to me that everything was not what it seemed, even as crime continued to decline as it related to the fundamental fairness of our criminal justice system in New York State. You know, I'm reminded of the story of that famous exhibit at the Jerusalem Zoo of the lion and the lamb, peacefully coexisting with each other in the same cage. And folks all over the world come to the Jerusalem Zoo. They're amazed at this exhibit. And the Secretary of State, one year, it's told, visited this exhibit, was amazed, and after the tour, pulled the zookeeper aside and said, "I can't believe this. How do you get it done, the lion and the lamb peacefully coexisting in the same cage day after day after day? What's your approach?" Zookeeper paused for a moment and said, "Mr. Secretary, it's pretty simple. Every day, we change the lamb." Things aren't always what they seem. And so we've got a criminal justice system that for many appears to be working in the way that it should. But I'm not convinced that if you actually pause, take a look at the system, and begin to ask some questions about what is really going on, that what is presented is actually beneath the surface what is taking place. And so when you think about what some have called the prison industrial complex, and you put it in the context of what the objectives of the criminal justice system should be. I remember as a law student, I've learned very early on in criminal law that there seem to be four legitimate objectives to punishment, to criminal justice, that all of you have learned: deterrence, retribution, incapacitation, and rehabilitation. But nowhere in criminal law did I learn that there was actually a fifth reason that could be used to justify the existence of the system that we've constructed, and that's economic development. Now, Dwight Eisenhower, of course, once famously warned the nation in his farewell speech at the end of his term in late 1960 or early 1961, of the rise of what he termed the military-industrial complex. And what Dwight Eisenhower, this World War II hero, no one more qualified to lay this out and to warn the nation, is that there seemed to be the possibility that a defense industry would emerge that wasn't necessarily concerned about national security, but that could become so powerful and so economically interested in a military machine that it could impact what takes place with our defense in a manner that perhaps had nothing to do with our national security. And what has happened here in New York is that there was a decision that was made in the 70s and in the 80s by Democrats and by Republicans, when the manufacturing base left large parts of rural upstate New York, when the automobile plants left, when the steel industry left, when the textile companies left to build prisons in their place. Some of you may be too young to remember one of my favorite movies growing up was Field of Dreams, starring Kevin Costner. And Field of Dreams was about some folks who had this crazy notion that they were going to build a baseball field in the middle of the cornfields of Iowa. And people thought that Kevin Costner and others were delusional in their view. But the persistent theme that you would hear around this idea that we're going to build this baseball field in the middle of the cornfields of Iowa is that if you build it, they will come. Throughout the entire movie, if you build it, they will come. And I've thought about that a lot when I think about the notion of how in the middle of all of these rural upstate communities, some counties where there are more cows than people, do you make a decision that we're going to spend hundreds of millions of dollars on prison construction? And then I thought about that some more, and I realized that there seemed to have been a view amongst some that if you build it, they will come. And the they, in many ways, became folks from a handful of communities, largely Black and Latino, largely poor, largely in New York City, and a few inner city, upstate locations like Syracuse or Buffalo or Albany or Rochester. And in order to sort of sustain this, and there have been comments that have been made by many of my colleagues of an opposite political persuasion, whenever the issue is raised about closing one of these correctional facilities, the immediate response is that it will do irreparable damage to our economy. And so an entire economy has grown up around the notion that when you get older, you will not be able to find a job in an automobile plant, but you can find a job as a correctional officer in a prison. And what that has done, I believe, in terms of its impact on public policy, just as Dwight Eisenhower warned as it relates to the military-industrial complex, is that you insert an issue and you create a constituency for the continuation of certain policies that may not even be effective as it relates to criminal justice, but have more to do with filling these prisons that have become essential to the economic survival of certain upstate communities. It was a terrible decision, and it has had considerable consequences. I remember when I first encountered this phenomenon in a meaningful way, Governor Spitzer, in his last budget, proposed closing four rural upstate correctional facilities because the inmate population in New York State had dropped from about 72,000 to about 59,000. And so there were correctional facilities all across the state of New York that were half empty, underutilized. Some juvenile detention facilities that had more correctional officers than they did young people or inmates. Spitzer proposes the closure of these four facilities, justified by the declining inmate population in New York State. We would have saved $10 million in the first year and $300 million in the out years. And not a single individual would have lost their job because the closures would have been accomplished through attrition, and those who were not planning on retiring could have been transferred to the nearest adjoining facility. Yet notwithstanding the fact that rational public policy should have said that Governor Spitzer in that instance is correct, even if it's from a fiscally sound point of view, there were forces in the state Senate who said, we will shut down the entire government if you close a single prison. And the arguments that were made had nothing to do with fiscal sanity. They had nothing to do with the need to keep those facilities open from a census standpoint. They had everything to do with the notion that these facilities had become part and parcel with the economic survival of certain communities. And that's had other effects. There was an effort for years to reform and repeal the so-called draconian Rockefeller drug laws. And I couldn't figure out for the life of me why in the world, if we have these laws on the books that were first put into place in the aftermath of the heroin epidemic in the early 70s, that were incredibly harsh and punitive, that would send nonviolent first-time offenders away without discretion for long periods of time, 10, 15, 20, in some instances, 25 years, why it was so difficult, if not impossible, to get these laws reformed. And I'm sure some of it had to do with the fact that people of goodwill were of the view that drugs are an evil thing in their society, and simply, and certainly, from my vantage point, I'm not an advocate of the legalization of drugs, but I am an advocate for a fair and rational and even-handed drug policy, and it was clear that the draconian Rockefeller drug laws had far outlived and exceeded their usefulness. But what also became equally clear to me is that the reason there was an inability to get these laws repealed is because there were individuals who had an economic interest in having harsh, punitive laws on the books to create a pipeline from certain communities downstate into certain prison communities upstate and sustain the argument that these correctional facilities should remain open. It's fortunate that when there was a change in power in 2009, and the party that I belonged to was able to get complete control of the legislature as well as the governor's mansion, that we were finally able, after many, many years, to repeal draconian Rockefeller drug laws and begin the process of dismantling this prison industrial complex. Let me say parenthetically that as we did that, we were also of the view that it was our responsibility to try and figure out ways that had nothing to do with the criminal justice system to revitalize these upstate communities. That it was the right thing to do to figure out how we can create a sustainable livelihood for those that were in struggling rural communities, but that it should not be done on the backs of the criminalization unnecessarily of others. We also, as we closely began to take a look at how, when we were given this political window between 2009 and 2010, that we could address the inequalities in the criminal justice system and work on remedying the effects of the prison industrial complex, what else could be done? And it was clear to me that we needed to address the out-of-control stop-and-frisk practices of the NYPD. Now, let me pause and say I think that Michael Bloomberg and Commissioner Kelly have done a tremendous job in many ways of reducing crime in New York City. And in fact, when you think about crime reduction in the city of New York, it goes back to the last 2 years of the Dinkins administration, continues through the 8 years of Rudolph Giuliani as mayor, another NYU law graduate. I don't claim that often. And then into what now is 10, 11 years of Michael Bloomberg and Ray Kelly. But in a democracy, it's clear to me that there has to be an appropriate balance between a healthy respect for civil rights and civil liberties on the one hand and effective law enforcement on the other. And as it relates to the stop and frisk activity of the NYPD, where according to their own statistics, each year, hundreds of thousands of otherwise innocent, law-abiding individuals are stopped, questioned, frisked, embarrassed, humiliated, and illegally searched in the view of many of us, the overwhelming majority of whom are Black and Latino, and perhaps more importantly, that according to the NYPD's own statistics, almost 90% of those who were stopped, questioned, and frisked did nothing wrong. No gun, no drugs, no weapon, no contraband, no arrest, nothing wrong at all. And then it was brought to our attention that not only were the police engaging in this aggressive stop and frisk activity, but on top of that, they were recording the names, addresses, perhaps even social security numbers, other personal information of the innocent law-abiding folks who were let go and putting it into a massive electronic database that could subject these people, there were more than a million names here in New York City in that database, to permanent criminal surveillance and the possibility of permanent criminal suspicion. And so I was proud to have been part of the effort on the Assembly side to sponsor the bill that ultimately became law that shut down the NYPD's stop and frisk database. Because it was clear that if we're going to tackle injustice and if we're going to tackle what had become a prison industrial complex, we had to do it from the front end as well as the back end. And I'll speak to that issue to some degree a little bit later. But there still is an aggressive program of stop and frisk activity that is taking place right now. More than 600,000 people continue to be subjected to this activity in any given year. And it's had an interesting impact, an intersection with this issue of marijuana arrest reform. I spoke for a minute about the Rockefeller drug laws and the impact that that was having on people adversely, with judges being deprived of the discretion to send people into drug treatment who could have benefited from it, nonviolent individuals. What we've now seen, we've gotten rid of Rockefeller, is that there's been an explosion of arrests in New York City for possession of small quantities of marijuana. More than 500,000 arrests that have taken place over the last decade. It's the number one arrest category in New York State. In 2010 alone, there were 50,000 people in New York City who were arrested for possession of small quantities of marijuana. These arrests, of course, have consequences. You get a criminal record. You can be prevented from getting a job. You can be stopped from getting into college. It can prevent you from obtaining financial aid. It can stop you from living in public housing. There even have been people who have lost their children in family court as a result of an arrest for the possession of small quantities of marijuana. Now, when I've thought about that, I've said to myself, well, you've got mayors, including this one, You've got governors. You've got presidents who have all acknowledged using marijuana at some point in their lives. We didn't run them through the system. We didn't ruin their lives as a result of a mistake that they now acknowledge. Why should we be ruining the lives of tens of thousands of people here in New York City? And from a law enforcement perspective, it doesn't even seem to make a lot of sense. It's a waste of money. $75 million spent every year in New York City on law enforcement activity, police overtime, and court costs related to the arrest and prosecution of marijuana. Now, why is this happening? It's interesting because in 1977, here in New York State, the New York State Legislature changed the classification of marijuana possession from a misdemeanor to a violation if the marijuana is not in plain view. And for decades, very few people in New York City were actually arrested in this area. But then came stop and frisk, that practice where hundreds of thousands are stopped and questioned and frisked and, in many instances, illegally searched. And it only happens in certain communities. And so what would occur is that young people would be approached by the police and asked to show us everything that you have. Empty your pockets. And if they happened to have some marijuana on them, had it remained in their pocket, because of the change in law in 1977, it was no longer a crime. But when they comply with a lawful, or at least a police directive, empty their pockets, take the marijuana out, all of a sudden it's in plain view. The handcuffs go on, and that is the reason why we've seen an explosion in marijuana arrests. In the view of many of us, it's classic entrapment, and it's fundamentally unfair. And it's only happening in certain communities, and as a result, it has had a racially disproportionate effect. And so 85% of the people who are arrested for possession of small quantities of marijuana are Black and Latino. Even though studies consistently show that young, more affluent whites use marijuana in equal, if not greater, numbers. But the stop and frisk activity doesn't happen in the Village. It doesn't happen on the Upper West Side. It doesn't happen in Williamsburg. And as a result, we've seen this racially discriminatory adverse impact. And the question that we have asked as it relates to this seeming unfairness is that possession of small quantities of marijuana is either a crime or it's not. But it can't be criminal activity for one group of people and socially acceptable behavior for others. And so I've introduced legislation in the Assembly to complete the job that was started in 1977. And it's co-sponsored by a Republican senator from upstate New York that would change the classification of plain view possession of small quantities of marijuana from a misdemeanor to a violation, so we can end the practice of needlessly ruining the lives of tens of thousands of individuals. And it's already had an impact, because in the fall, Police Commissioner Kelly issued an extraordinary directive saying end the practice of illegal marijuana arrests, and they've begun to drop. In this legislative session, we plan on fighting as hard as we can to change the law so that we can permanently change this unfair aspect of drug policy in New York State that is opening the gateway for people to be put into the system in a way that could adversely affect them for the rest of their lives. The last thing that I'd like to talk about, and certainly want to leave some time for questions, is this other issue that we've tackled, which in many ways was perhaps the most shocking to me, as it related to the system that had been constructed in New York State, and that was the manner in which incarcerated individuals were counted in New York and in every other state in the country for purposes of legislative redistricting. And so for decades, incarcerated individuals who come largely from a few communities across the state, like Bedford-Stuyvesant and Harlem and the South Bronx and Brownsville and East New York and Southeast Queens and a few rough inner city upstate neighborhoods, make up a disproportionate amount of the system. And the average individual incarcerated in New York State spends only 3 years behind bars, and then they come back home. Yet, for purposes of legislative redistricting done every 10 years pursuant to the census, they were being counted as residents of the upstate communities where they were temporarily incarcerated. Well, why did we think that this was wrong? These incarcerated individuals can't vote. They don't participate in local civic life. And the cost of their incarceration was paid for not by the local county or municipality, but by the state. And the overwhelming majority, when they're finished with their sentence, come back home. And they come back home, and it is our communities that then bear the responsibility of paying for their successful reentry and the housing and the employment and the educational opportunities and the social service delivery necessary to successfully reintegrate them back into society. Yet, we were counting them as residents of the upstate communities where they were temporarily incarcerated, and it had consequences. Right now, the Senate is divided, 32 Republicans and 30 Democrats, yet there are 7 state Senate districts that would not meet the minimum population requirement in New York State if it were not for the fact that incarcerated individuals were counted as residents of those upstate communities. And so the balance of power has been swung, and all 7 of those districts are represented by right of center or right wing individuals who are then elected to come to Albany on the backs of the incarcerated individuals who are counted as residents of those communities to then vote to sustain the policies that fuel the prison industrial complex, to fight against prison closures, to stand up against the effort to reform the Rockefeller drug laws, to fight us on trying to strike a balance between effective law enforcement and a healthy respect for civil rights and civil liberties through stop and frisk reform or marijuana arrest reform. But I'm thankful that in 2010, and this was a law that I was pleased to have authored on the assembly side along with the current New York State Attorney General Eric Schneiderman, who was then a New York State senator. And after Maryland, New York State became the second state in the nation to change the way that incarcerated individuals are counted for purposes of legislative redistricting, and they will now be counted as residents of their home communities. It will impact those disenfranchised communities, and hopefully it will remove the incentive that exists now for a variety of reasons to support policies that are highly punitive, irresponsibly unnecessary, and designed to continue the pipeline of folks from certain communities into the prison system. How do we create a more perfect union? I'm hopeful that through our reforms in the criminal justice system, we've taken a few steps forward in that regard, and I'm looking forward to continuing the fight in this area and beyond.
Ladies and gentlemen, I think you now know what I meant by a serious politician. What I meant is someone who's serious about ideas, someone who has a very serious moral view about the world, and a serious commitment to the high ideals of American government at its best. Assemblyman Jeffries is willing to and encouraged and looking forward to hearing from you now, so please step up to the mic. Tell us who you are and ask a question. It's a great opportunity. It's a great opportunity not to be bashful. Well, I could start with the first one. Okay. Why don't I do that to kind of clear the ice? All right, yeah, you want to take her? While we do that, I actually want to take you back. This is going to be a strange question, folks. I want to take you back to actually before you even started talking about your ideas for reforming criminal justice and to focus you on something that you're going to think is really bizarre, but I think we don't talk about enough in law school or out there in the world, which is failure. What was it like to lose an election? And tell us how losing an election actually contributed to your path as a politician today.
Yeah, you know, it's a great question. And certainly I think that adversity is a necessary part of life. And in many ways, you know, political adversity, when you run a race and you lose, in many ways tests your character in a way that should hopefully make you a better leader. Now, fortunately, because of the struggles of many who have come before us, Congressman Guarini and his generation made the greatest sacrifice, confronted tremendous adversity. Many people paid with their lives, others demonstrated tremendous bravery, and through that adversity, we became a better country. From my own individual standpoint, you know, I sort of traveled along a path where I was reasonably successful academically at every level as I moved forward. Certainly grew up in a tough neighborhood, but in a moderate income to middle class upbringing within that context. Had some success in my post-law school career with the clerkships and the jobs that I was able to acquire. But having that experience when you get knocked down on the ground and figuring out, do you have the confidence, the ability to pick yourself up, move forward, and persuade others that we can build upon this loss to be successful moving forward was a test that I decided to embrace. And as a result, I think it made me stronger. And certainly when I've looked at others whose political careers have risen to the very zenith of American government, the two examples I'll cite right now, of course, are Bill Clinton and Barack Obama, commonly viewed not just as brilliant individuals, both of them are, but as incredibly skillful orators and charismatic politicians. And if you look at the fact that Bill Clinton could lose his first race for Congress in 1974 when Democrats were winning all over the country because of Watergate, but he challenged a Republican congressperson and lost, with all of his credentials, brilliance, and charisma, could pick himself back up off the ground and move forward, and that Barack Obama could run for the United States Congress in 2000, get knocked down on the ground, lose to an incumbent by 25 points, pick himself up off of the ground, and not only run for Congress, but run for a seat in the United States Senate, that is clear to me that adversity, political adversity, just like in every other field of human endeavor, is a part of life, and you should embrace it, learn from it, and you'll successfully be able to move forward.
Hi, my name is Ben Furness, and I'm a 3L here. I'm wondering if you could just talk a little bit about what it's like as someone who does a lot with housing policy, representing a neighborhood that's undergoing a lot of economic change, and sort of balancing the needs of people who live in the neighborhood who'd like to see it stay very similar, affordability concerns with the change in economic conditions. Thanks.
Yeah, it's a great question. The communities that I currently represent in Brooklyn, Fort Greene, Clinton Hill, Prospect Heights, as well as parts of Crown Heights and Bedford-Stuyvesant, but certainly in Fort Greene and Clinton Hill and Prospect Heights, we've seen tremendous change in those communities. It wasn't too long ago that those were communities that were defined by the abandoned buildings, the crack epidemic, broken glass from shattered car windows littering the street corner. And some of you who are familiar with Brooklyn know that the G train is very important in those communities. But when I was growing up, you couldn't pay me to take the G train. In fact, it was one of the most dangerous lines in the system. I used to think that the G stood for gangster. And so now, this is a gentrifying community. And a lot of the people who have moved into the community were drawn by the diversity of the community, racially, socioeconomically, culturally, artistically. But what we found as a result of the skyrocketing housing prices is that that diversity is now under tremendous threat. And that some of the people, young people, seniors, middle-class folks, working families, artists, who were part of the transformation of what the neighborhoods were to what they are right now, have become victims of their own success. And that's a painful thing when you can't even benefit from the fruits of your own labor. And it's a message, though, that I think has some resonance with folks who have moved into the community because many of them were attracted to that diversity. And I think can rationally understand that unless we come up with an aggressive, affordable housing policy, not just for those neighborhoods, but for all of New York City, that much of what we love, the cultures from all over the place, the people who come from all over the world, the racial mix, the socioeconomic mix, the ability for artists to thrive and live in the community will all be lost. And so I don't think that affordable housing and gentrification and that struggle is one that should be divisive, because in many ways it's not a black issue, it's not a white issue, it's not a brown issue, it's all about the color of green. And it's a unifying issue around the notion of preserving the great diversity that we have in New York City.
Hi, my name is Ian. I actually live in the Gowanus neighborhood of Brooklyn. I think it's right at the border of the district you're running in. And I'm curious, it seems like you're
hopefully
having...
Hopefully, for my sake, you're in.
Right, yeah. That's true. I'm curious as to... It seems like you're having a lot of success in a short period of time pushing through what most people would say are progressive policy initiatives as to why you feel the desire to right now challenge an entrenched incumbent where if you win, you're going to be on the left of the party and not have maybe as much success for a long time?
Yeah, it's a great question. And, you know, I've been fascinated as I've sort of traveled throughout the community. When I first ran for the Assembly, and certainly when I was even elected in 2006, I remember folks saying to me, why in the world would you want to leave this practice that you're developing to go to that cauldron of dysfunction up in Albany? And I've met a little bit of success, and we've gotten our act together to some degree in Albany. But I'm fascinated now because I often hear the question, why in the world would you want to leave that bastion of democracy in Albany to go to that cauldron of dysfunction down in Washington, D.C.? But I think that the same spirit that caused me to want to serve in the legislature and the ability to get some important things done at this moment leads me to want to attempt to do the same thing down in Washington, D.C. at this moment in time, where we're faced with, I think, an assault on our values that's coming from some in the radical right. And we're really in a struggle for the heart and soul of what kind of America we're going to become. When we have things that were so fundamentally important to us, like civil rights and women's rights and workers' rights and reproductive rights, immigration rights, all under assault. And that to sit there when there was an opportunity to serve at a higher level and more forcefully advocate for progressive values important to the communities that I represent and beyond, that taking the risk and a tough challenge facing a well-entrenched 30-year incumbent was the right thing to do because of this moment in time that we're in our politics in America.
Okay, let's make this the last question.
Hello, my name is Cesar Francia, I'm a 1L, and I'm a resident of Prospect Heights, Brooklyn. I really enjoy supporting minority-owned businesses, and I've noticed a few in Prospect Heights area, but I was wondering if there's any legislation in the work that supports and strengthens and increases, that would help and spur more businesses, especially minority-owned businesses, in the state of New York and specifically in Brooklyn.
Yeah, in 2010, we were able to, and I was talking earlier with some students about moments in time that provide for political opportunity to get some important things done. And in that cycle in New York, 2009, 2010, where we had a Democratic-controlled assembly that has always been progressive-driven, but we also had a temporary control of the Senate by the Democratic Party, which they subsequently lost in the 2010 general elections, and a governor who was willing to do some progressive things, that we were able to tackle not just some of these issues that I talked about with respect to dismantling pieces of the prison industrial complex, but on women and minority-owned businesses to pass historic legislation that strengthened the opportunities for businesses in Brooklyn and Prospect Heights and beyond to at least participate in state government contracting, procurement, services, as well as some of the more professional aspects of state government that aren't often thought about from an MWBE perspective, like the management of our public money, more than $100 billion in a New York State pension fund, requiring a lot of financial professionals and lawyers and bond counsel, all of which are opportunities that are now open to qualified people of all races and all genders across the state of New York. And hopefully we'll start to see those opportunities manifest themselves in a more meaningful way based on the legislation that we passed in 2010.
I'd just like to do three brief things by way of wrapping up. First of all, to alert you what you don't need to be alerted to, which is that there's a lovely spread behind you, which will be available to everyone in a moment. Second, to call to your attention the fact that next Monday, January 30th at 6 o'clock in this very room, there will be a Leaders in Public Interest series presentation by a panel devoted to the topic, is social justice best promoted by being a prosecutor or public defender? A provocative topic that builds very naturally on the remarks that Assemblyman Jeffries shared with us this evening. And finally, I would like to salute for one more time two individuals, two members of my rare breed of serious politicians. Congressman Guarini, would you come up, please, sir, and take a bow? And Assemblyman Jeffries, the two of you.
Thank you very much.
You know, one of the things that went through my mind when Hakeem talked about in order to have a more perfect union, I think it's a realization of the fact that we probably never will have a perfect union, but democracy isn't supposed to be perfect. It's supposed to be a gathering of thoughts and something that deals with all of us. So there's a lot of give and take. And of course, you see that in leadership. In Washington, I think it's dysfunctional right now because the leadership is missing. You won't have a perfect government any place. In fact, I think it was Tony B that said in the study of the rise and fall of governments that there is in each government the seeds of its own destruction. And it reminds me of something that was said by Benjamin Franklin when they struck the Constitution in Philadelphia, Liberty Hall. He came out and he was approached by a woman. And she said, "Tell me, Mr. Franklin, what kind of government do we have?" Benjamin Franklin looked at the woman and he said, "You have a republic, madam, if you can keep it." And that's a very interesting thought, because we all have to work very hard at keeping what we have, which is the greatest government, which is the greatest country that the world has ever known. It becomes part of all of us to put back and contribute to the country that we think is so great. We love our flag, we love our nation, we love our community, we love our family. But all of that is going to be safeguarded because of your vigilance and the good work that Hakeem and his friends are doing. So I want to thank you very much for all that you said. I lost my voice. This is not my speaking voice. Thank you very much. Incidentally, Hakeem, you mentioned two men who lost their election, Clinton and Obama, our past presidents. But the one man who lost more election than anybody who ever ran for president was Abraham Lincoln. And he lost his election, ran for Congress, I don't know how many times, for the United States Senate. But he kept at it, and he wouldn't quit. And he had in his heart that he wanted to serve, and he wanted to do something for his country. And he finally got elected President of the United States and made a big difference, because without him, the Civil War would have been a different war completely, and we may have a different country today. Well, thank you very much, and I thank you for all the good things you were doing, Sam. We're very proud of you. Thank you.